blessed us with. We come to worship this morning. And we have announcements. Don't forget our evening worship service begins tonight at 6 p.m. Wanda's on Wednesday night at 6 p.m. also. Children and youth Christmas play practice will begin this evening at 5 p.m. Anything?
No.
Everybody be out for that. Looking forward to seeing them. This is going to be the last day for Operation Christmas Child Items this year. We're down to the wire. Next Sunday will be our dedication service. And so we need, if you can get it in today, washcloths, combs, pencil sharpeners, small hammers, coloring books, small notebooks, and lots of stuffed animals needed. I don't know if Shelly can still shop for you, though. Maybe this afternoon. But this will be the last night to pack.
So we need it before tonight so we can finish up.
As of this morning, we had how many?
Our goal was 325, and we now have packed and ready to go 361 boxes.
We have 15 empty boxes over there. That's the most we could pack this evening if we had the stuff. So that's all we got left is 15 boxes. So if you want to help out with that this evening, you can do that. And I guess they'll be packing tonight, finishing up. So, and also, if you'd like to donate, each box is $9 for shipping, which that includes the gospel presentation. And so we've already got 74 boxes paid for. If you want to do that, you can also contribute to that. Our Lottie Moon Christmas offering goal is $1,300. In your bulletin, it says total to date $75. This morning in Sunday school, we got $750 toward Lottie Moon. And so, amen to that. If you don't know what Lottie Moon is, I'm going to tell you what Lottie Moon is. The first important thing you need to realize about the Lottie Moon Christmas offering goal, 100% of your donation goes towards the missionaries. There's no overhead, no bureaucracy or nothing. 100% of what you give goes directly to missionaries. The Lottie Moon Christmas offering is an annual offering collected by Southern Baptists to support international missions. The offering was officially named in 1918 by Women's Missionary Union in honor of the missionary to China who urged churches to start it and give sacrificially. Y'all like statistics? I can't say it. Through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, Southern Baptists have given over $5 billion to international members, international missions. $5 billion, that's with a B. Alright, this 422 new missionaries, 18,380 new churches, 86,587 people baptized, 144,322 new believers, and 769,494 people heard the gospel witness. That's what the Lottie Moon Christmas offering is all about. And so $130 lights a window. We only have four windows left. Pretty much the first day we've started this, so we praise God for that. Our Thanksgiving Christmas dinner will be December the 12th. After the morning,
ice cream, ice cream for ice cream, but November the 14th, Sunday night, after service, we're going to have ice cream in the fellowship hall. We'll be loading up our shoe boxes that night as well.
All right.
Come be a part of that.
Any other announcements? In our Sunday school hour, we had 29 in attendance. We had an offering of $433. We also had 86 contacts turned in. Appreciate that. 19 daily Bible readers. We also received $100 in shipping costs. And we also, as I mentioned before, the $750 for Lottie Moon. And so we appreciate all those offerings this morning. Anybody have a birthday in the past week? Who are you for now? All right.
Johnny, I want to say I'm glad she has a birthday.
Amen.
Sing a song this morning about America the Beautiful. If you will get your hymn books, turn to page 630. We're going to sing the first, third, and the fourth. I believe, right? And I think there's only three in there. So anyway, we're going to sing those. If I know we've got a string. You can't hardly read it. Hopefully next Sunday we'll have our TVs up if all goes well. So y'all be praying about that. And I know this morning we had a lot of prayer needs in our church this morning. Just pray for our church as a whole. Pray for our youth. Pray for everyone. I failed to mention too this morning. Pray for Central Baptist Church this morning. Brother Darrell and a bunch of family members within that church has COVID. They're not meeting. I think they're doing Facebook Live, doing outside in the parking lot type service. So Matt Wilson has just been just got voted in pastor there last week. So. When it comes down to it, it's just Satan just does not want to see a church continue going on. And I just pray for our church, head of protection. And I know today, this next week, we'll be looking at Veterans Day, November the 11th. And at this time this morning, we're going to sing a song called America the Beautiful. But I would like to recognize those within our church that's here this morning that would that have fought for our country, men and women, fought for our country. You mind standing up? We could just recognize you, if you don't mind. You mind standing? Okay. We appreciate that so very much. And I'll say this. I know there's a lot of people that want to disrespect the flag, and I know that's a freedom everybody has. I mean, it's my opinion that for people that fought for our country and those type of things, I think we owe them the respect because we're able to worship here today in spirit and truth and freedom. I tell you what, it's just, I appreciate you guys so very much. Y'all give them another hand this morning. Let's stand. We're going to sing 630 in the hymn book, America the Beautiful. We'll sing the first, third, and the fourth. Everybody sing that.
Thank you. do this morning? We're going to sing one song before we get into the message this morning. Going to be preaching this morning out of the book of Galatians. And in fact, if you don't mind, just put it on the screen, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. It says, "I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Listen, as I start to try to sing a song called "Crucified with Christ." When I look back at what I thought was living, I'm amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really mattered, 'cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. When I finally reached the point of giving in, I found the cross was calling even
and
crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we just thank you for so many blessings. God, thank you so much for all you've done for us. God, thank you that we have these promises in your word, God, that we can take to heart, Lord. And we're so thankful, God, that we can rely, Lord, in our position in you, God, and knowing, Lord, what you've done for us. Lord, I pray that you would help us today to just grow an appreciation and just look back and know, God, that you're the one. You're the one that's done it all, God. We thank you for your Son, Jesus. God, thank you for sending that road across for us. Lord, I pray today as I preach this message laid on my heart, I pray, God, that you would speak through me. God, make speech easy. Lord, help us understand, God. And I pray when it's all said and done, Lord, I pray as we leave the doors today, God, that we can say, thank you, Lord. If someone here within our voice today does not know you as Lord and Savior, I pray today will be the day to give a heart and life to you. God, we pray for everyone online, everybody, God, that may be associated, Lord, through social media. I just pray, Lord, for somebody out there that's searching, God, and the only thing that's going to be able to fill up your Son, Jesus. Help them reach out to us, Lord. Again, we love you and we praise you, Lord, for all that you do. I lift up this church to you. God, I pray today, if it's the last message ever preached, Lord, it'll be found in your will. God, I pray again that you would forgive me for anything, God, that would affect this message. Again, we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. But we see, as far as Galatians is concerned, and I love that verse there. And one thing today, as far as the title of the message, I guess you could say, would be Through Christ, You Can Do It. And I know I started thinking about a lot of different slogans. And how many of y'all remember when you care enough to send the very best? Y'all remember what that was?
Hallmark.
I knew Shelly would know Hallmark. She loves cards. Do y'all remember It's the Real Thing? What was that?
Coke.
I figured Alan would know that since he's working Coke. Have It Your Way. Do y'all remember that?
Burger King.
Okay. The Breakfast of Champions. Wheaties. Okay. When I was growing up, y'all probably remember seeing Bruce Jenner, you know, go to, you know, I know that name now, I guess he calls himself Caitlin, yeah. But you'd see Bruce Jenner, you know, on the box is what I remember. And Breakfast of Champions. Y'all remember Where's the Beef? That's Wendy's, wasn't it? But you remember different slogans? Yeah, different slogans. We'll get past all of this. I just didn't know if y'all were remembering them. But I started thinking about one. And I know I said earlier, as far as the veterans are concerned, as far as our flag is concerned, there's another one that's actually the most popular one. And it's Just Do It. Y'all know who that is? That's Nike, right? And honestly, because of their stand that they've taken, this is me, this ain't in God's Word, the stand they've taken concerning the flag and promoting the guy that kneeled, I don't buy any more of them. I'll just be honest with you. I don't do it. And I've got a pair I use for cutting grass and, you know, and that kind of thing that I've had, but I don't buy any more. That's just my personal opinion. But they would say Just Do It. And it was, again, a most popular slogan, and it's really just a simple slogan. But I started thinking about this. You know, people hear it, they think, I can do it. If you actually do it, you know, if you actually run, believe it or not. We just talked about it at work. I've told y'all before, if you see me running, you better be running too, because something's chasing me, okay? That's just the way it is. But, you know, you see them run, ride, bike, you see them swim, hike, play golf, all these different things. But when it's all said and done, you know, most of them just don't do it. You know, when they say just do it, most of them just don't do it. They have all the fancy slogans and shoes and that kind of thing, but it did not inspire them to do anything but be able to spend their money, you know, on those items. And I know a lot of us, too, we can actually relate to this. You may have exercise equipment in storage. You do that? Okay. Not too long ago, bought a bike, and yeah, it's in storage. So that's one of those things we see that time and time again. My mother, I joke with her all the time. She has a treadmill. Y'all know I love my mom and my dad, but she's more for hanging up clothes than she does actually. Right. Y'all ever do anything like that? You don't do nothing like that, do you? But I started thinking about things like that, and I know when we talk about buying shoes and that kind of thing, when I was growing up, Chuck Taylor's Converse, that was a thing. I mean, you just felt like If you have those, you can play some basketball. And I'll never forget the very first pair I ever got. I think it wasn't even Chuck Taylor's. I think it's kind of a knockoff brand. But it was high tops, lace-ups. I thought, man, I can jump up there and dunk the ball, you know. And I'll never forget, I'm not kidding you, beside my grandmother's house, if my mom and dad had a trailer, I can remember this day, black high-top shoes, I tied my shoes up, got my basketball, I ran out there, and my dad had a goal, it was about a 5 foot, 6 foot goal, it was a smaller goal because I was young. And I remember taking off, thinking I could dunk it, and I didn't get over it close. That phrase, white men can't jump, that's really hurt me. But I really thought I could do it. I really thought I could do it. I thought, man, I could jump up there and dunk it. And so I'm kind of relating that to this as far as we think about slogans and that kind of thing. But this morning we're going to talk about Christ, and through Christ you can do it. And I started thinking about slogans, you know, preachers, and a lot of times it's like us sharing slogans. We say, just do it. You know, we say, just give your all to Christ. Just give it all to Him. Just live for Jesus. You know, be all that you can be for Him in faith. And we say, just get up. You know, get in, go out. Go out there and share God's Word. And we talk about that. And the majority of that hear the message, you know, they say, well, that's wonderful. You know, that's wonderful. Somebody needs to go out the doors. They need to share Jesus. You know, some of them need to do that, you know. And I want to, and they say that, and they hear the word, they believe the message, but when you get down to it, most of them didn't hear anything about it. And if I'm not preaching the truth, I know I am, because I've been there. We've all been there. The sermons you heard that you're moved by, basically what they're doing is just collecting dust in your memory bank today. That's just the honest truth. It don't have to be that way. And Paul here, he heard the message of Christ and said, that's who I want to be. That's who I want to be. And today, as a pastor and a preacher and Christian foremost, that's who I want to be. Now, I know I'm a far ways from being like Jesus. All of us are, but we've got to strive to do our best to live for Him each and every day. That's what I want to be. When I was growing up, I know I've shared this before. Larry Bird was my favorite basketball player of all time. How many of you like Larry Bird? Did y'all like Larry Bird? Okay, good. Y'all are my favorites. I like Larry Bird.
Larry Bird.
Do what now?
Larry.
Oh, my goodness. Don't do that. I'm just kidding. But that was old school Celtics. I love Larry Bird. And I'll never forget, when I was growing up, I loved sports. And y'all may have loved sports too. I love sports. I love basketball. I love baseball. But basketball was my sport. I loved it. And I would actually hope and pray one day. You know, I look at that Sports Illustrated. Y'all remember those? We had everything on social media. And I seen one picture of Larry Bird sitting there. And my dream was, man, I'm going to be sitting right there beside him one day. We're going to be playing for the Boston Celtics. Well, guess what? It didn't happen, okay? It didn't happen that way. But I wanted to be like him. I know some people say be like Mike. I wanted to be like Larry Bird. I'll never forget, I'm getting to a point here in just a minute. I'll never forget back whenever you recorded games on VCR tapes. Y'all remember that? We did that, and I would watch, and I would repeat. And honestly, I can tell you this day exactly how I shot free throws. I watched him, and I mimicked everything he done. And that's who I wanted to be. And when I was in high school, if I could play a good game, and if I could go to school the next day, and they would say, Wayne, man, that was a great, great game you played. I mean, that's what I wanted to hear. Yeah, I wanted to hear those type of things. But just so you know, those things are fading, okay? They're fading. And what I want to hear today, is not any applause by anyone other than the audience and one, and that's God. And I know within y'all's lives, I could talk. I know there's people in our church and our congregation, just as y'all saw, just in offerings, that just giving folks. And I know some of y'all that shared Christ and they give it their all. And I do, as a pastor, I'll say, I appreciate the job you're doing. You know, I appreciate, you know, you going and sharing your faith. I appreciate it. I'm not trying to make, but the one of them said, well, I'm not doing it for you. You know, I'm doing it for God. Hey, that's what it's all about. You know, whatever we're doing, if we're going to just do it, if we're going to go through Christ, We know today that we can do it. So this verse here teaches us that every believer can walk like Jesus every day. And this verse here has some truths that can help us do it, because as we get, if we look at this verse, we got to realize our position in Christ. Notice it says, I am crucified with Christ. If you notice, there's a lot of I's, there's a lot of me's there. And that's a past position, that's a perfect tense, I am crucified. And what that talks about, it refers to a once and for all action that never needs to be repeated. You know, Paul is saying here, I'm crucified when Jesus was crucified. And that crucified was a one-time thing, once and for all experience. I was crucified, and I also stand crucified. So what does that mean for you? This morning, if you're saved, then when Jesus died on the cross, you died with him. If we can look at Romans chapter 6, verse 4, and I know all of our church that comes on Wednesday night to our Bible study, we've been studying through the book of Romans, and I actually got reminded of something we talked about a few weeks back. But notice it mentions in Romans chapter 6, it says, therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall all also be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. So we see the believer's baptized, he's placed into to being identified with Christ in the resurrection. The true believer, they put off the old man of sin and put on the new man of godliness and righteousness. Now notice, he took our old man to the cross with him when he died. And where it said there in verse 6, it says, notice, it's that the body of sin might be destroyed. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. Now, now you start thinking about the body of sin. Notice that it ain't got the word S at the end of it. It ain't the body of sins. We know that there's many sins, but it all encompasses the body of sin. That's the whole package of sin is what it's talking about there. And it goes on to say, might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. It was here the price for sin was forever paid in full. We can look at Romans chapter 6, verse 23. We've talked about this verse a lot, and it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Ain't you so thankful that death has no power over us, amen, as a child of God? We don't have to worry about it. It has no power over us, because in our present position, not only does Paul tell us the believer is dead because of being crucified with Christ, but he also says the believer is also alive. If you will go back to Galatians chapter 2, the first scripture we shared, Brady, if you don't mind. If you notice here, it says, I'm crucified with Christ. And notice it says, nevertheless, I live. It says, I live. That's present tense. Yes, we died with him by faith in Jesus, but he's raised us from the death of sin and made us eternally alive. I'm crucified with Christ, never I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Also look at John chapter 5, verse 25. It says, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Eternal life. It does not begin when we get to heaven. Eternal life begins the moment that you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. We know that it said, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If you were listening to Kevin Hammond this morning, he brought out some things in that verse I'd never even thought about. It was just a great a great message he preached this morning. But we look at John chapter 10, verse 28. It says, I give unto them eternal life. It doesn't have an asterisk there or anything, does it? It says, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. And a lot of times we read that verse, and it's got the word "and" there, the first part of it. So go back to verse 27 of John chapter 10. It says, my sheep, is talking to the Christians, people, says, hear my voice, I know them, and knows what it says, and they follow me. Now those are red letters, I know it's not on the screen, but who's me? Who's that talking about?
Jesus.
We've got to follow Jesus. You've got to fall in love with Jesus. My sheep hear my voice, I know them, they follow me. We've got to follow him. Whenever we come to know Jesus Christ, and I think this is a problem a lot of times in people that I talk to time and time again, they're searching. They're searching for something. You won't believe the people I've talked to. I tell you what I'll do. I'll go to church. You know, I'll do this, go that, and they may come a couple, two or three Sundays. And what happens is they kind of think, well, if I do this, then maybe this, you know, will get better. This situation will get better. That kind of thing. When we're not promised, it's not going to be easy. We know that from reading Scripture. But the problem is that we got to follow him. You can't follow me. Now, as a pastor, and as an example, y'all know I'm not perfect, and y'all know that. But if I'm following Jesus, I'm going to do my best to lead you there. But you can't follow a pastor. You can't follow a church. You can't even follow a denomination. Anything like that. You've got to follow who? Jesus. Jesus. So, how are you being led today? Well, not only, and we can talk about that further, if you can go back to Galatians chapter 2, your position in Christ, the very first scripture, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but it says, yet not I. We've got to realize that we're relying on the power of Christ. He's quit, Paul is, to credit his ability to live the Christian life to the Lord Jesus Christ. He knows what we need to know. That it's all about him. It's nothing about us. We've got to depend on him. Now, I know we say that a lot. We say it kind of in passing. But do you really realize it's nothing about us? It's about what God has done, what he has done. But we have the power of his resurrection. Because I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but notice right here, but Christ liveth in me. He lives in me. He died on the cross. He rose the third day. And just as Jesus rose from the grave, different than when he was buried, everyone that comes to him by faith is altered forever. Amen. We see in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, how he can make you a new creation. New creature. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. God, Jesus, can do it. I'm not just alive. I'm not just alive. I'm not just breathing here today. But notice, but he is alive in me. And not just me. If you're a Christian here today, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if I was to say today, if you was to die today, would heaven be your home? If there's any doubt, guess what? He's not only living in me, but he's also living in you. That's we've got to rely on the power of Christ. But notice the word in. The power of that red. It says Christ liveth in me. He moves into that person's heart, giving power to live like him. Amen? We see that here. The fact that Christ is within us is the only thing that is able to make the Christian life possible. Because I ain't worth nothing. I promise you. We're honest with ourselves, we're not worth anything. But if we're a Christian, guess what? He lives within us. We see that here. So not only are we realizing our position and relying on the power of Christ, I know we can preach on that even further, but we're also resting in our position and also the promises of Christ. There is a supply of faith. Notice, if we was to go back to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, he says, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And notice, it's the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That Paul makes the strong statement that faith given to him by Jesus is what makes his life possible. You know, God provided the faith we need. You know, would you agree this morning that you're saved by faith? If we look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, it says, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Verse 9, it says, not of works, lest any man should boast. If we was to go back to verse 8 there, would you agree that we're saved by faith? Where does the faith come from? It's not of yourselves, it's what? The gift of God. Y'all remember we saw in Romans 6:23 where it talks about the gift of God. So how do we exercise that faith? If we would go to Romans 10, verse 17. So when we talk about that faith, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by what? The Word of God. The Word of God. As we hear the Word of God, and we take God at His Word, that helps us to build our faith stronger. Help us grow in our faith. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Now I know this is not the exact way to look at this verse, but it's just a thought that hit me this morning. This last week, what have you been listening to? What have you been hearing? Are you hearing the world's agenda? Are you looking at what's going on around us, or just whatever the case may be? What have you been listening to? Are you listening to all of these other things, or are you listening to the Word of God? I'll be afraid to say that most of us are listening to what's going on around us rather than the Word of God. And as a Christian, all of us deal with emotions, and that's one thing about emotions. It comes and goes. And that's one thing. You never want to go on your feelings, on anything like that. But we're talking about something that goes beyond anything. That we've got to have our hope, we've got to have that peace that only comes through Jesus Christ. We've got to depend on it. And the faith that we got, to build the faith, to have the attitude that Paul had here, we have to hear the Word of God to grow. To grow. You can read the Word of God on your own. You just got to pick it up and read it. Well, I don't feel like it. I've had a rough day. I'm telling you guys, you've got to get in God's Word. I think I told him Sunday night, I can tell when I get up, and I know a lot of times I get to work early, I read some, even at my desk, to get going, I just reading your Bible on a regular, daily basis. I sometimes sermon prep on lunch. I just, you know, kind of get to myself there and that kind of thing. I can tell if I wake up late, didn't get to do what I normally do, my normal routine, get to work on time, and I ain't done my Bible study that morning or my devotion time. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Can you tell the difference if you don't get in God's Word daily? Whenever we have to hunt our Bible on Sunday morning because we don't know where we placed it at the Sunday before, something's wrong with our relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you know how I know this? Because I'm speaking of experience. All of us. This is what's going to get you through the day. This is what's going to get you, again, to not pay attention to what's going on with the things around us. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. If we can go back to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, there's a sacrifice of his flesh. We've read the verse about 100 times, no leading up to it. This is going to be the last point I have. If you would, read it with me if you'd like to. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen? To think about, I live by the faith of what? The Son of God. The Son of God. That's what we've got to have faith in. Who loved me. And now, who gave himself to me? Everything I've talked about is possible only because Jesus Christ willingly went to that old ugly cross. Amen? He did that for me, and he did it for you. He bore our sins in his own body. He took our place. I deserved to be beaten. I deserved to be crucified. But I'm thankful that he did it for me. And that's the reason, I know as I said earlier, through Christ you can do it. When we think about Paul, how he heard the message of Christ, he said, that's what I want to be. That's what I want to be. To think about this verse, to think about what God has done and how he's blessed us so very much, I've heard people say, you know, well, I'm seeking to be crucified with Christ. That's not what it's about. We've already been crucified with Christ. We are to live by faith in the Son of God. When problems arise, when things hit us, you know, we know we can go to God and pray. We can pray. As believers, we can pray. We've talked about all different prayer requests even this morning. But our faith is not in one person or a church or not. It's in Jesus Christ. We've got to trust in him. Because as we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3 and 4, this is basically the gospel. In a nutshell, it talks about Paul saying, for I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Think about what God has done, what Jesus Christ has done in taking our place. I used to want to be known by, hey, Wayne, that was a good play you made. Wayne, that was a good game that you played. That's where I found my satisfaction. But you know, there was a time where I didn't play basketball any longer. And I know I'm just using that as an example. In your life, you maybe want to be known by this thing or that thing. This morning, I want to encourage you to be known as a Christian. To be known as a sold-out Christian for God. You know what makes a difference in our lives today and in our community? Is when we gather today to worship, yes, we gather to worship. And I'm thankful that we're able to gather. I'm thankful that God has saw us through, I know, the last couple of years and all the uncertainty in the world. But you know what makes a difference in our community and people we work with and our families and our home? Is walking out those doors seeing changed people living separate lives from the world. Amen? To see God do a work. Seeing people walk in that's lost and leave saved and changed. That's what makes that's the biggest testimony anybody could have. So your life today, is that what you want to be? Do you want to be a sold out believer of Jesus Christ? That's what I want to be. That's what I want to be. That's my goal. That's my goal. I'm learning. I'm still growing. I don't believe you quit growing. You just keep on keeping on. And I want to encourage you to grow. And how we're able to do that is through what? Jesus. Through His Word. Amen. That's what we see here. But this morning, as Shelly comes to play verse invitation, if we could go back to Romans 10 and 17. He says, "And faith come by hearing. By hearing and hearing by the word of God." We've shown you in Scripture. We've talked to you numerous times how to be saved. But if you just receive it by faith, you believe on Him, you can be saved. And I think a lot of times we hear the word and maybe God is dealing with your heart. You may be a Christian here this morning and God is just dealing with you about your relationship with Him. Don't let the devil sit there and say, you know, don't do this, don't do that. Everybody will know. I'll tell you, I've been there too. Is your life where it needs to be? Are we truly putting Him first? And can we say, like Paul, that's who I want to be? I want to be like him. I don't want to be like Mike. I don't want to be like Larry Bird. I want to be like Jesus. I want to be like God. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about that more tonight in our service tonight as far as what I'm preaching on. But I don't know if you just bow your head as we have a time of invitation. I'm not God, so I'm not all-knowing. I don't know what's in your heart. I don't know what. I just know this is a message that God has given me. We've got to trust in Him. We've got to believe in Him. Maybe you feel Him knocking on your heart's door this morning. Maybe you've never known Jesus Christ as your Savior. Just open the door and let Him in. God would come to you as some know how. God, knowing this is your invitation time, God, I pray that as we're here, as we're bowing our heads, as we're praying, as believers, I pray if there's anybody here that doesn't know His Lord and Savior today, be the day to give their heart and life to you. God, we love you. Again, we thank you for all you do. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. As you bless.